Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. It's time for the Q&A section. I have received many good questions this time. Some of the questions need more time to be answered satisfactorily. So, I won't be able to answer them all in today's video. Let's take a quick look at the question for today. First, from Fred Talks, Jin vs. Qi. Second, from Justin Mungo. The first question is force transfer and pressure on feet. The third question from Justin Mungo as well, energy transfer within the body for healing. Question number 4, Eglot 12, Qigong in Kung Fu form. Question number 5 from Mr. Thomas Hudacek, Tai Chi sword. Question number 6 from Alex Wu Navarro, Chen Zhaopi's 17 days contest. Question number 7 from Cesar Escalante, Li Dian in Tai Chi. Question number 8 from Robin Andrews, Silk Reeling versus Silk Pulling. Question number 9 from Alexei Panko, Xing Yi 5 Elements and Head Defense. Question number 10 from Lover Boy, Fa Jin. As always, all the questions have been time-stamped in the description, so you can feel free to skip over to the questions that interest you. So, without any further ado, let's get started. Question number 1 from Fred Talks asks, what is the nuance of a Jin versus Qi as both translates to energy? Jin means martial force, martial power, or martial energy. Well, Qi is the general term for energy. Jin is always tangible and Qi may be intangible. Jin is used in martial art practice and Qi can be used in both martial practice and Shudao practice. But its meaning varies according to the practice. Qi is one example of the Chinese language phenomenon where one word can have multiple meanings based on the context. Fred, I hope this answers your question. Let's look at the next question. Justin Mungo asks two questions. Here's the first question. Previously, on one of your videos, you mentioned pressing the feet into the ground when you feel a bounce to transfer to the fourth up to the higher area. My question is, do you pressure just the heel or do you need to press the whole foot into the ground? The answer is very simple. Use the whole foot but start from the entire foot, not the heel. This is the key. Justin, the second question. Can you transfer the energy coming up to a specific area of the body for healing to bring qi to a particular area of the body? Short answer, no. Martial energy is for self-defense purposes, especially in Fajin movements. Healing energy is gained through specific energy practice such as Daoist Qigong, not martial art practice. The word energy has different meanings in martial practice and Qigong practice, even though both of them involve the term energy. Justin, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next question. Eglot 12 asks, is it true that one can practice Kung Fu form from any style in such a way that it becomes a Qigong practice? Before I answer your question, it's important to clarify the differences between the term Kung Fu form and Kung Fu movement. Kung Fu form should reflect the originally intended spirit and the nature of the practice. Kung Fu movements, on the other hand, can have variations in nature while still maintaining resemblance to the original form. With these differences in mind, the other factor is how you define qigong. Any kung fu form can become a qigong-like practice as long as you manage the physical movement and the mental activity according to the traditional qigong standard. Furthermore, in your question, you use the phrase in such a way. Then the key question here becomes, what exactly are these ways, if any? Well, the Gong Fu way and the Qi Gong way are mutually exclusive. If the movement uses the Gong Fu way, it cannot use the Qi Gong way. Plus, there are different styles of Qi Gong, such as Taoist Qi Gong, Medical Qi Gong, Martial Qi Gong, and so on. It may be easier to convert a Gong Fu movement to a martial qigong practice, but the same cannot be said for other type of qigong. Bear in mind that a kung fu form is designed for combat. Movements used in kung fu are mostly oriented outward. However, qigong movements are designed to cultivate and refine energy, which are oriented inward. There is already a major difference in terms of the orientation of movements. So, in my opinion, it's easier and also preferable to practice the already established arts instead of trying to convert one practice to another. I hope that answers your question. Let's move on to the next one. Mr. Thomas Hodacek asks a question regarding the Tai Chi sword. Quote, is there an original sword form or an oldest sword form? Because Yang style and Wudang style share a lot of same sequences and Chen is different, but is this older? The legend says Wudang is the oldest, right? I suspect that all of them are not very old. End quote. Mr. Hodachas is a Tai Chi teacher in Austria. His YouTube channel is linked in the description. I recommend you check it out. Thank you, Mr. Hodachas, for this great question. And your suspicion about the history of Tai Chi sword is largely correct. Swords have been useful as a weapon for thousands of years in China. The ancient Chinese produced very well-designed sword. For example, the sword Yue Wang Gou Jian Jian, currently preserved at Hubei Museum, has more than 2,500 years of history and is still very sharp. Also, many sword training manuals have been written over the years. For example, the Hun Yuan Jian Jing, written by Bi Kun, in the Yuan Dynasty, approximately 700 years ago, integrated Xiudao practice and the martial sword practice, which makes the document unique and valuable. So, if someone claims that Wudang sword practice is very old, then I have to say, yes, it is older than me and all the people that are alive today, except maybe Zhang Sanfeng. I'm kidding, of course. But the Wudang sword is definitely not as good as many traditional sword systems. Throughout history, only hard blade swords were ever used in battle. That's one important factor to bear in mind. Now, let's talk about the Tai Chi sword. If you read any Tai Chi document written more than 150 years ago, you will not find any systematic record about the Tai Chi sword practice at all. In Tai Chi, sword practice is pretty new compared to the empty hand form. In other words, well-designed Tai Chi sword practice cannot be older than 150 years. Based on my research, the Tai Chi sword in each style, including Chen, Yang, Wu Hao, Wu, and Sun styles, were developed much after the development of the Emily Han styles. Furthermore, I don't believe that Yang style sword is developed based on Chen style, nor other styles, since sword practice is not an original weapon of the Tai Chi system. In a prior video titled Understanding Xing Yi Bagua Tai Chi Through Contract 8, Imagery of a Weapon, I have mentioned that the movements in Chen style Tai Chi bear resemblance to Guan Dao movement, not sword movements. Link is in the description. Please have a look if you haven't not already. Since sword practice has thousands of years worth of history in China, Tai Chi masters from different generations were able to borrow different styles of sword practice and integrate them into their own Tai Chi practice. As a result, different styles of Tai Chi developed their own routines and practices based on Tai Chi principles. It is no wonder that Tai Chi sword practice are different in each style of Tai Chi. Another question worth asking here. Was Tai Chi sword practice created for self-defense? Well, most likely not. Of course, you can practice sword for self-defense, but Tai Chi sword routines were created for understanding and improving Tai Chi practice. Also, let's talk about the material used in Tai Chi sword. You may have noticed that the Tai Chi sword is not a typical hard blade sword. Instead, normally 30% of the sword body is soft and very flexible. Do you think that kind of sword could be used on the battlefield? Nobody in their right mind would use such a sword in an actual battle. That kind of sword is only meant for Tai Chi practice. Now, let's talk about the Wudang sword. You have to know that the Wudang sword is not the same as the Tai Chi sword. Wudang sword is just Wudang sword. And even in Wudang Mountain, there are different types of Wudang sword routines and practices. Ma Jie, a famous martial artist of Tianjin, practiced the Wudang sword, and he also brought the routine back to Wudang Mountain in the 1980s. I talked about it with Ma Jie himself, and he told me that Wudang sword is just Wudang sword, which has nothing to do with Tai Chi sword. Of course, Wudang Tai Chi practitioners practice Wudang Tai Chi sword, but that is a very new routine, and this routine was created by Li Tianji, a famous martial artist who lived from 1915 to 1996. He studied Xing Yi with his father Li Yulin. Li Yulin learned Xing Yi mainly from Hao Enguang and also from Li Cunyi and Zhang Zhaodong, Tai Chi from Yang Chengfu, and Wudang sword from Li Jinglin. So, Li Tianji created the Wudang Tai Chi sword routine based on Wudang sword and Yang style Tai Chi sword practice back in the 1960s and the 1970s. So, Wudang Tai Chi sword is actually the youngest Tai Chi sword practice compared to other major Tai Chi sword practices. Ms. Hudachek, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next question. Alex Wu Navarro asks, there are different versions of the story of how Chen Zhaopi established himself in Beijing and started teaching before moving to Nanjing and asked Chen Fa Ke to come to Beijing. I have heard and read different versions ranging from Chen Zhaopi waiting people to come and challenge him during a single day, which sound like a story downplaying his skills as almost no one could show up, to spending 18 days fighting and winning 200 people opt a journal article, which sounded like a virgin inflating his skill and this over 10 fights a day. Well, since this question is related to history, anyone making a claim would need to provide supporting evidence. I have heard about this story before and have also asked many people in China about it. The information I have about this story so far indicates that Chen Zhaopi did, in fact, conduct his event in Beijing. However, the small article published in a local newspaper said, I quote, 河南温县陈家沟武师陈兆丕在宣武区立擂台，愿与天下的武林朋友、武林豪杰交朋友。陈先生住在杜胜兴商号，有与陈先生切磋武艺的，请到杜胜兴商号联系。End quote. Translation: Chen Village martial artist Chen Zhaopi holds a Tai擂台 in Xuanwu District of Beijing.Would like to make friends with martial artist. He lived at Du Sheng Xing Shanghao, a business name. If you want to test his practice, please contact Du Sheng Xing. End translation. After that small article, there was no further follow-up in that newspaper. In other words, there exists no official record of the 17 days of fighting.Based on Chinese culture, if he won or lost in fighting, then the newspaper would report it. I persistently asked many martial artists in China about the result of that competition. Not a single one of them could give me any specific detail. Most of them just told me that there were no official fights at all. So whoever claims Chen Zhaopi fought over 10runs a day need to show their evidence. By the way, Chen Zhaopi was a great Tai Chi master. He studied Tai Chi from his uncle, Chen Fa Ke. However, claiming that he was so great because he won 17 straight fights worth of competition in Beijing is a bit too much and unnecessary. I feel such embellishments, in fact, ruin the actual legacy of the practitioner. Most people love stories, and most stories are just that, stories, which have little to no basis in reality. Alex, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next one. Cesar Escalante asks, could you explain what Li Dian means in Tai Chi Chuan?Thank you. The term Li Dian consists of two characters. Li means force or power. Dian means point. Put together, Li Dian is the point to apply power or force. So, where exactly is the Li Dian in martial practice? Well, whenever you strike your opponent, the area of contact on the opponent's bodyis considered Li Dian since you have to release power or force on that point. Li Dian is a relatively new term and have been gaining popularity in the last couple of decades ago. There are some interesting practices involving Li Dian, which I will introduce in the future. But I hope this answers your question for now. Let's move on to the next one.Robin Andrew asks, gave explanation of the difference between pulling silk and reeling silk. Is pulling silk a characteristic of a Yang style Tai Chi, whereas reeling silk is a characteristic of a Chen style Tai Chi? This is a very interesting question. To those who may not be familiar with these terms, let me explain them briefly. Chen Si Jin, or silk reeling energy is the term created by Chen Xin. Chen Xin was a great Chen style martial artist and also the author of Chen Shi Tai Chi Quan Tu Shuo, or illustration of Chen Xiao Tai Chi, the best ever Chen Xiao Tai Chi document. In his book, Chen Xin emphasized the importance of silk reeling by not only saying that Tai Chi Chuan is the practice of silk reeling, but more importantly, he also introduced detailed silk reeling practice in that book through each Tai Chi movement. Chou Si Jin, or silk pulling energy, is a term created by Wu Yuxiang, the founder of Wuhao style Tai Chi. In his article, Wu Yuxiang said, quote, "Mai bu ru mao xing, yun jin ru chou si." Translation: step like a cat and move the energy like pulling silk. End translation. I have a video titled Tai Chi Stepping Like a Cat. If you have not watched it yet, please have a look. Link is in the description. The relationship between Chan Si Jin and Chou Si Jin is that Chan Si Jin, or silk reeling, is a specific Tai Chi energy practice or spiral motion of Tai Chi movement, while Chou Si Jin, or silk pulling, is the characteristics of Tai Chi movement. In other words, Tai Chi practice should be as subtle and careful as pulling silk. Each movement should be carefully handled in practice. So, Chou Si Jin, or silk pulling, talks about the characteristics of a Tai Chi movement, and not about a type of energy as described by Chan Si Jin, or silk reeling energy. Literally, some people in the Tai Chi community have been using Chou Si Jin, or silk pulling, to describe the Yang Xiao Tai Chi practice, since Yang Xiao Tai Chi routine looks evenly paced. Actually, it is not precise, since Chou Si Jin, or silk pulling, is not a new type of energy. It is rather just a term used to describe subtle and carefully managed Tai Chi movements like I just mentioned. Robin, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next one. Alexey Panko asks, what type of protection against blows to the head are in the five elements and in Xingyi in general? I have introduced the Xingyi practice system in a prior video titled Xingyi, Building Blocks, Requirement and Expectation. If you have not watched it yet, please have a look. Link is in the description. In that video, I mentioned that Xingyi five element practice is the practice of the five type of power release, not specifically meant for self-defense or combat purposes. Of course, you can use it for combat, but that is not the original motivation behind five elements practice. Regarding specific techniques used to protect the head against attacks, there are many general techniques which can be found in many movements. For example, you can block with your arms or retreat back and so on. All of those movements can be found in many typical Xingyi movements. For example, tiger movements can be used for it. In martial art practice, you should focus on training your instincts and not just specific techniques. I hope I have answered your question, Alexey. Now let's look at the final question for today. Lover Boys asks, I would like to ask you if there's any way to know if one's Fa Jin is correct. I have noticed that when you do your Fa Jin, there's a very smooth execution, just like water flowing, no stop, no hesitation at all. Thank you for your comment. Lover Boy, you are very lucky if that's your real name. Anyway, I have to say that Fa Jin is the key to any internal martial art. Without Fa Jin, any internal martial art practice will be useless. Of course, there are different types of Fa Jin, but basically, you have to be able to execute the power release and transfer power to the opponent's body, which is the key of Fa Jin. So, what is the standard governing Fajin? Basically, the power should be smooth and natural, even at full speed. Power, by definition, needs speed. So, without speed, it can no longer be called power release of Fajin. Also, this power should be effective against your opponent, otherwise it cannot be called Fajin either. I plan to talk more about Fajin in the future since it is a key topic in the internal style of martial art practice and deserves a detailed explanation, but I hope this suffices for now. That brings us to the end of this Q&A. If my answers end up creating more questions, bring them on. I will follow those up in future videos. As always, thank you for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.